So speaking of the future, so, you know, the industry's changing so fast. You know, in Indian country, we're kind of, you know, we think we got an understanding of the industry, and I think we do have the brick and mortars, but now the industry's changing. We talked about DFS. I was down at the D downtown and looking at their new esports microenvironment. You know, it's iGaming is still out there in California. We had legislation. Now there's talk that I think it's starting to build momentum again. I know some of you probably heard me say this before. But so where are we with iGaming for both of us?
You know, I think that we're prepared. We've tried to get to our folks to understand that that's inevitably that it's out there. I don't think it's a game maker or a deal breaker or anything like that. I think it's a component that could help to change America's economy and help to do something that, again, we talk about illegal dollars. People do it all over the world, but if they're going to legalize it here in the United States, we've asked the folks in Washington to understand tribal sovereignty and make sure we incorporate the rights of the tribes' governments. And we've also asked the tribes to engage and to do the different types of opportunities to get involved in this industry so that if and when this takes off, it doesn't take off without us. We understand it, but most importantly, that they understand our tribal compacts, our ability to engage in this as governments. And we're already, with the help of the National Tribal Gaming Regulators Association in Indian Country, they're already developed draft regulations and technical standards already. They're already working on that, so we're prepared. But, you know, we want whatever comes forward, we want to see a document that respects tribal sovereignty. That's our bottom line.
So a few things I'd add on to that about online gaming. One, you mentioned earlier differences between tribal and commercial. And I mentioned there are differences within commercial. Online gaming is a great example. We don't have consensus within the commercial industry on that issue, so we're focusing on areas where we do have consensus. That's the best use of our time. That's what drove us to sports betting. That's what drove us to a lot of other issues where we have that consensus. I think that's important. I also think, and it's important that we acknowledge this, we learned a lot of lessons from what went wrong in the online gaming debate. And a lot of those lessons are feeding how we're approaching sports betting. I would agree, tribes were not consulted enough on the front end of the online gaming debate, and nor were lotteries and other interested parties. If we want to get something done, we need to do it in a transparent way and work together from the outset, and that's exactly what we're doing on an issue like sports betting. So lessons have been learned from what went wrong in that debate. The final point I'd make, though, is that we live as an industry in a highly competitive environment. Yet a lot of the policies we confront are based on the misguided notion that casinos operate like monopolies. They print money and they cause some social harm. That couldn't be any further from the truth today, where we have a $240 billion industry in 40 states. But those policies often restrict us from providing the product that our customers want, from being nimble and efficient and able to update our products the same way your iPhone is updating your apps every single night. We have to evolve as an industry. We have to be more nimble, and we need regulators and policymakers that understand that we're operating in a fundamentally different environment today than we were 5, 10, 20 years ago.
Victor, if I could just say, you know, we do have, of course, our technical standards drafts and working with the national regulators, which is a separate body entirely. But I think that a lot of folks are concerned about whether our positions on it, because you read the paper and you see a lot of different viewpoints. But I want to make sure that the industry understands that our regulators and our tribal leaders have been together on this issue when it started to formulate, started to hear about draft proposals out there in Washington, D.C. So we've analyzed that. And probably for at least, going back even to the first 109th Congress, I'm totally off there, I think. But when the law came through to as it related to internet gaming, we still weighed in back then. But after that, over the last several years, we've taken a more diligent approach to it, and the tribal leaders have met. And again, there has been disagreement and some studies and working together, but when it was all done, we drafted 10 principles that we have worked by. So even though there are different viewpoints, we have several, I shouldn't say 10 principles, but we have principles that we have related to tribal governments and different things that impact any gaming. Those principles have been made available to anybody that the tribal leaders have spoken, and we are getting united behind those principles.
You know, it just seems to me, you know, as while this conversation has gone on about iGaming, the world has kept moving forward. You know, we're in California, we're talking about iPoker, and yet the rest of the world is talking about like, these new forms of like DFS and going back to sports betting and stuff like that. So I do find it amazing what we're fighting over this, or that the industry is trying to figure out what's going on, and the world moves on, doesn't it?
It does, and I would add to that, I don't think it's a coincidence, and it's an issue I don't have an answer for today, but I would just throw this out at you. I don't think it's a coincidence that the innovation that we see happening around the industry in terms of daily fantasy sports, esports, social games, at one point online gaming, they're all operating in the gray market. That's where a lot of the innovation is taking place. And a question we have to ask ourselves is, how do we bring some of these innovative products, once they've proven that they have an ability to attract new customers, how do we bring them into the regulated market? All of us operate in a very heavily regulated market without squashing that innovative nature that they had in the first place. I think that's a real challenge we're going to have in the future, because the gray market will continue to produce some new and very creative ideas.
Well, you know, last night I went down to the D Casino, and I was looking at their esports, but he talks about they're going to get ready to start taking the first bets on esports.
Yep.
You know, he said they're going to be low stakes. It's going to be, but you know, it's a new world.
Yeah, if you haven't been down there, Seth Shore down at the D has built a whole esports lounge where people are coming in, they're playing video games, they want to take bets on this. It's a new product for a casino, it's very interesting. Is it going to make any money? Nobody knows. But that type of trial and error is exactly what we need to have the regulatory freedom to have, and hopefully we'll have more in the future.
Yeah, it's very exciting. Kind of going back, you guys have this program called the Get to Know Gaming program. Could you give us a little more information on this? This seems to be like number one issue with the American Gaming Association.
Yeah, I think that traditionally, NIGA, the AGA, have been excellent lobbyists, sending incredibly talented people to Capitol Hill to affect public policy and share the stories of the various industries over the years. But I think one thing we've embraced at the AGA, and it's something that Chairman Stevens and I have talked a lot about, is this idea that policy is a direct descendant of perception. And if we don't improve the perception of our industry, we can't drive the favorable policy that all of us seek. So the AGA has invested quite significantly in the storytelling for this industry. We do it through research. We do it through going into local communities and highlighting what our various properties are doing, from Detroit to St. Louis, Columbus and Cleveland, going in, doing these on-the-ground local events. We as an industry, I think, have a responsibility and need to do a bit better at telling the story of our local economic contributions, the partnerships we're building with philanthropic organizations and other nonprofits. That storytelling is critical to empowering policymakers to create more favorable policy in the future.
You know, I think that we go back to when they started putting the Indian Gaming Regulatory Act together. We go back to Cabazon, most importantly, because it's a major victory for tribes. But as we move forward in the industry, so many people created so many myths and legends about what we were going to be. And through the Get to Know Indian Country, back in the 1980s and 1990s, we've been able to utilize our, not just NIGA, but our regional organizations to really help America get to know Indian Country. So this is a natural for us to tag on to the front and educate folks, because we've been able to let people know not only have we defeated those myths and legends about what gaming was going to be in Indian Country, we've been able to educate folks about how important our lives, the jobs, the opportunity for the housing and the adequate things that we're, you know, most Americans take for granted that we never had. These things are starting to flourish in Indian Country, still have a long ways to go, still have a lot of tribes that don't have these same advantages, but I think one of the key components that makes us successful under that is our regulation. You know, 6,500 employees are spending $426 million on regulation. No matter what we do, that has to be our priority, and that's why we're not close. There's talk about it, but we're already talking about regulating.
The commercial industry can learn a lot from what tribal gaming has effectively done, particularly in Washington understand the contributions, the value. I would agree, a far better job in telling a very effective story.
I think this is where the get to know part of it, that the jobs that that gaming provides in this country, in this whole world, are amazing. And I think that's where our constituents like to see us work together, because we can better educate America and the world about what this industry is. It's a good industry, it's a hard-working industry, it's an honest and highly regulated industry.
Absolutely. You know, we are stronger together, and we are better together. You know, I mean, it's a no-brainer. And, you know, we are going to have disagreements, and we are going to have knockdown, drag-out fights, but I think we as an industry, we need...
We'll lose those fights.
We need to be together to go forward, because there's still a lot of threats, you know.
I think there's a good referee, that's why we're moving forward.
Listen, I'm all about the industry, man. I want us all to succeed, and we all can all